Bible says in the beginning was the Word. And so Jesus is eternal. He's always existed. He was here before the worlds were created. And it says the Word was with God. In other words, Jesus is distinct from the Father. And so they're two separate personalities, both Father and Son. So the Word was with the Father. It says the Word was God, which doesn't mean that Jesus is the Father, but it means that Jesus is deity. As a Son of God, He has Godhead powers and is God. And John 1:14 says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten Father, full of grace and truth." And so the Word became flesh. Jesus became flesh. God loved us so much that He sent His only Son to come here and be our representative. And Jesus loved us so much that He was willing to leave the splendors of heaven and come down and become a human being. That would be equivalent to one of us becoming an ant and giving up our human privileges to become an ant. It's that big of a drop. And so Jesus loved us so much that He was willing to sacrifice. He gave up everything to become one of us. I read a story about a farmer who didn't believe in the incarnation because in his mind he reasoned, why would God come to earth and become a man? And then one Christmas Eve, a blizzard hit the farm. And he was in his house and he could hear geese out honking outside. And so he went outside and he saw some wild geese out in the pasture. These were geese who had been separated from the flock. And so he knew they wouldn't survive the blizzard. And so he went in and he opened the barn door so that they could go in the barn and be warm. But the geese wouldn't go in the barn. And so he got a sack of grain. And he made a trail of grain from the pasture into the barn. But the geese wouldn't follow the trail of grain. And so he thought to himself, if I could just become a goose, then I could save the geese. And so he had an idea and he got one of his domestic geese and he took it out and he put it in the middle of the wild geese. And so his domestic goose flew into the barn. And when he did, all the wild geese followed him into the barn. And the farmer shut the doors and the geese were warm that night. And so that night he understood why Jesus Christ would come to earth. He accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior. And the next day on Christmas Day, he thanked God for sending his only son. And then he enjoyed a dinner of roasted goose and dressing. And so Jesus came and became one of us. The Word dwelt among us. And the Greek word for dwelt is the same word that we get our word tabernacle from. And in the Old Testament, the tabernacle was the dwelling place of God. It was the meeting place between God and man. It's where they worship God. And so Jesus is a meeting place between God and man. He was fully God, yet He was fully man. He faced all the temptations that we face, and He faced all the problems and trouble that we face, yet He did it without sin. And he tasted death for every man so that He could destroy the power of death, that we no longer have to fear death. And so you can't get to the Father except through Jesus Christ. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." He's the way to the Father. He's the way that we can approach the Father and be accepted by Him. I read a story about an Australian couple who went to Bangladesh to minister to the Muslims and be missionaries to the Muslims. And they lived in Bangladesh for 6 years and they didn't have any success and did not have even one convert. And so they were discouraged and they went back home to Australia. And then 2 years later they went back to another city in Bangladesh, and this time they lived as Muslims. And they dressed as Muslims and they followed Muslim customs and culture. And this time they learned how to share the gospel to Muslims, and they were successful and had many converts because they became one of them. When Jesus came to earth, and He became one of us. Yes. Come on, He walked with us and talked with us. He lived with us. He lived as a human being. And He learned about the things that He suffered. He went through everything that we've gone through. And because of that, He can understand our situations. And the Bible says to come boldly before the throne of grace and obtain help and mercy in time of need, because we have a faithful high priest who understands, who's been through everything that you've been through. And because of that, He understands and He's able to help you And he's always there for you because he understands what people go through. And the Bible really is a story about two men. And the first one was Adam. And God created Adam because he wanted a family, because he wanted fellowship. And Adam walked and talked with God in the garden. He was the representative for the entire human race. But because of his sin, he was separated from God. And he had to leave the garden. And because of that, then trouble came upon the earth. And we were born in Adam because he was our father. And what was in Adam was passed down to every human being that was ever born. And so we were all born separated from God. We were all born in a sinful condition. So God sent another man to become the second representative of the human race. That man was Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:45 says, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. And so the first man, Adam, was created from the dust of the earth. And God breathed life into him. But he brought sin and death into the world. And so the first Adam brought death to those who followed him. But the second Adam brought life to those who believe in him. And our lives are changed and transformed as we put our faith in him. And so your first birth identified you with Adam. And you were identified with who he was. And so God didn't create the whole human race at one time. But he created one man and one woman and let them reproduce. And what was in them, their genetics, was passed down to us. And they lived in paradise until they sinned and broke fellowship with God. And so the Apostle Paul said, through one man's sin, disobedience came upon all men. Amen. And so we're all born in sin because of what Adam did. And the condition that he was in had an effect upon us. And so we can't help ourselves because we're born in that condition. You say, well, what can I do? Well, Jesus said, you must be born again. Come on, many folks, many times people say, I was born that way. I just can't help myself. And that's why you need to get born again. Amen? But Jesus was born of a virgin. He became the second representative of a human race. He lived a sinless life. He paid the price for our sins. And then he died and he rose again. He was on the earth for 40 days and then he ascended into heaven. And for today, he's a right hand at the right hand of the Father, directing and leading the body of Christ. And so when Jesus died, he did so as our representative. And when he died, then I died. Amen? When he was buried, then I was buried. And when he was raised, then I was raised to new life. And so the first Adam was a slave to Satan. And the second Adam defeated Satan. Yes. The first Adam brought death, but the second Adam brought life. The first Adam stayed in the grave, but the second Adam rose from the grave. Amen. Yes. Jesus came to earth. He took man's condition upon himself. He died with our condition. And when he did, then we died with him. Romans 5:17 says, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. So when we receive God's grace and the gift of righteousness, the Bible says we will reign in life. Not be defeated, not be overcome, but reign in life, amen, and be a success in life. And we receive God's grace. And so it's a gift that's given to us. God so loved the world that he sent his only son to pay the price for our sins. And it's a gift of grace that is offered to us. But it's up to us to receive that gift. Amen? And when we say, thank you, God, I thank you that you sent Jesus Christ to die for my sins. And we ask for forgiveness of sins and accept him as Savior and Lord. In other words, commit our life to live for him. The Bible says that we're forgiven, that we're saved, that we're in right standing with God. Amen? Right standing with God means that I can come before God without a sense of inferiority or fear, but knowing that I'm accepted and I am his child. That's what Jesus Christ has done for us, and that's why we celebrate the birth of Jesus, because of the great price that he's paid. If everybody could just bow their heads this morning, I just want to pray a prayer. If anyone's here today and you've never accepted Christ as your personal Savior, I want to give you the opportunity to do so today. You know, it's important that it's not just knowing about Jesus and knowing that he lived and that he was the Son of God, but it's making it personal and accepting him as our Savior and giving our life to him. That's important. And there may be some here today that you just want to make a prayer, a recommitment prayer, and just recommit your life to him today. There's no better time to do that than on Christmas Day. And so if you just repeat after me, say, Dear Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I confess my sin to you, and I ask for forgiveness. And I commit my life to you, that I'll live for you all the days of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me today. Amen. It's just that simple. And the important thing is that you meant what you prayed in your heart. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer, the Bible says that you're saved, that you're born again. Amen. That you're in right relationship with God. And that's something you accept by faith. And sometimes folks say, well, you know, I don't really feel like I'm saved. I don't really feel like I'm in right relationship with God. But you know, faith is not feeling. Faith is based on the Word of God and what it says. And if we do what God told us to do, then he will keep his promise to us. Amen. And the word is true. At this time, I'd like our ushers to come and serve us. Community.